I come to you as a fellow griever, and also one who has sat with hundreds of people sharing their stories. And one of the many things that I've learned is that loss is a universal experience. It may show differently, it may be expressed differently, but everybody feels it. And the other things I've learned is that so is joy, and so is peace. And hopefully by the end of this discussion, we figure out ways that will help us get through this. Because as many of you know, it's one of the hardest things you'll do in life, is to make sense out of something that is beyond understanding many times. What do you want to know about? Do you know what I mean? Yeah.
I'd like to know more about anticipatory grief.
For those of you who wonder what that is, it is when you know somebody has a life-limiting time on this earth. So from that time where the doctor says, you know, you have 3 months to live until the actual moment of death, what that time is like. Anticipate. Anybody else? No? Okay. The what?
Complicated.
Good one.
Unexpected. I don't know, loss of a child.
We're just
fear is
a, that's such a huge one.
Grief mingled with anger and resentment.
So the feelings, sure. We deal with loss every day. There are all different kinds of loss. Some of you may have experienced loss in these last month through the storms. Lost your house, lost your furniture. The loss of expectations are one huge thing. You expected your house to not be flooded. You expect it to have four limbs, and all of a sudden you get into a car accident where you lose your arm. You expect people to behave in a certain way, and they don't. All of that, it has to do with loss and change. And some of us take it, we fight it more, and other people take it more in stride, like the weather. Why does it have to be so cold in March? You know, why does it have to be raining? I'm sick of this, I'm sick of that. It all has to do with what is in front of us, rather than what we want or what we had. And grief becomes the bottom line of that experience. It is the ultimate dealing with change. We spend our time in grief wanting what we had, and we're afraid of what's in front of us, the fear of the unknown. So I would like to talk about right now where I come from. I've lost a child. That was my first loss, which totally threw me into a loop. I had no idea, first of all, how difficult it would be. And second of all, what it impacts. It impacted me physically. It impacted me mentally. It impacted me socially. And it impacted me spiritually. And I think that is a pretty common experience. What was difficult for me was not finding many people that would understand that process. So you get weird kind of comments, like, you're so happy. You must be so happy you have other children. And things like that, that are just, they hurt almost. And the big thing I learned through all of it is that I am the only one who goes through this. I can have a buddy, but I'm the only one that can walk it. And that, I call it the existential moment in life, where we basically are responsible for ourselves, that we walk the world, and depending upon where we walk depends on how much help we get. I lost my father, I lost my brother, and I lost my mom. All of those losses, and if you talk and share your losses, have a different experience. My dad was a sudden death, so that when we were waiting for all our family members to come to drive to the funeral, I was looking for my dad. That's what happens with a sudden death. Your mind gets in a shock and basically kind of shuts down. It can't take it in. You know, it's like, who are you talking to? Who, what? You know, it's like, and that takes a long time, and it takes an intermittent time. Like, I remember sitting with a woman, and her husband had died 6 months earlier. And she thought she was moving along, as they say. And she said, all of a sudden, at 6 months, I went, what just happened to my life? What happened? You're still trying to get it. It's not like one thing you've like, oh, geez, he died, and you move, try to, you kind of keep trying to get it. Every little memory brings up other feelings. With my brother, he was 42. So his death was different because he was young. He had a lot of things. He was a professor. He wanted to do a lot of things. His torture was different than my dad's. Or my mom's. My mom was 96. She lived a good life. She didn't struggle very much. So everybody has a different kind of death. Some of the other things that affect what kind of death it is, as I said, what's the nature of the death? Was it sudden? Was it violent? Was it planned? Was it a long-term illness? Was it self-inflicted? All those are very different reactions, not only within ourselves, but also with our society. We kind of judge deaths. Suicide, we don't like so much. Little children, we get lots of support for that. Older people, well, they're going to die anyway. You know, it's kind of like, I don't know why we judge it, but we do. And one of the things I learned is to stop judging, to just keep quiet and listen to what people have to say and what their life is like. And feel free to ask any question during this time if you've had experiences such as this, which it sounds like you did. Feel free to share your experience or your questions. The other thing that determines grief is what kind of relationship you've had with the person who's died. So you have parents with a child. If the child has died, younger, teenager, older, a partner. If relationships are good, It's one kind of experience. If relationships are complicated, like we've just not been talking to each other for 3 months, we just had a fight before he walked out of the door, we've struggled with drug abuse for years, all of the, I even have people who have divorced, but one of the people have gotten ill and also come back and take care of that person. Their grief is going to be very different. So relationship is one. I mean, the second one. Personality. Each one of us here is a different kind of personality. So you can be an intellectual kind of person. You approach life in your mind. It serves you. Your grief's going to be very different than an emotional kind of person, a sensitive person. They need to talk. They need to cry. They need to express emotion. The intellectual, not so much. They don't like that. The people who are kind of controlling people, you know, they line up everything. Everything's got its place. When grief happens, the rug gets pulled out from you, and you feel like everything's kind of floating. You feel unanchored. Nothing makes sense. And you're trying desperately to try to find some hold on your life. The caretaker, the one who has cared for somebody as they're ill, or that's their role in life. When they're people that have died, they feel like they have no role anymore. How do they take care of themselves? They're very good at taking care of other people, but this is a new experience now. How do I take care of myself? There are religious people who rely on their faith. And when a death happens, there are some people that lose their faith. They don't understand why the person, the God they believe in, would do such a thing to them. They feel unanchored. They feel shaken. And the other thing that I think is really important is the messages we receive from our family from here on up. So I feel sorry for the men in life who most of the time receive messages from our culture, let alone our family, buck up. Buck up, you know, that's not manly. Whereas women feel a lot of permission and criticism for being emotional. Oh, she's so emotional. That's why people can't become president, because they're too emotional. You know, this is what our culture tells us. So when you're thrown in this grief situation, all those kinds of things shoot up, like, oh my God, I'm crying all the time. What's wrong with me? Or the men who are frustrated because they go hang out with their buddies and there's an avoidance that happens. In fact, most people want to avoid it anyway because they don't want to upset you. And what usually happens is you're waiting for somebody to bring up the person's name, to ask you how you are, and to really listen to how you're feeling, rather than, I'm sorry I upset you, as if you're not upset before the person asked. Previous losses are going to determine what kind of reaction you have to the current loss. So that if somebody talked about delayed grief, if you've had losses previous in your life and you've been one to kind of get busy and get through it, when you have another loss, that loss is going to pop up. And in fact, more than one loss is going to pop up. I remember, and it comes in very unique kind of ways. I remember speaking to a woman who I'd never met. She was a phone call. And she was talking about, she just lost her job. She didn't lose her job. Her boss was leaving the job. And she was very emotional, very upset. So I was trying to discover with her what was upsetting her so much. And after about 20 minutes, She said, "My brother died when I was 12. He was 14. They went swimming, and her brother died, and she felt like she couldn't save him." That came up from her boss leaving. So that's kind of how it comes up. You may not have thought of somebody who died for years, and then something happens to trigger it. And you may even say, "Why am I thinking about that? I haven't thought about that for years." The reason you're thinking about it is you have some, it needs to pay, you need to pay attention to it. Because the messages we get from grief about how to get over it are what? What do people usually tell you?
Using time.
What is it? I thought somebody said, it's either get busy or give it time. And many people don't talk about, it, this takes work. This takes attention. We need to pay attention to ourselves as far as what is going on. I talk about four tasks that we need to do in order to get on the other side of it. I don't say get over it because I don't even know what that means. But to get on the other side of it. Right now in grief, I always talk about if this is your life, grief fits the whole thing. You can't even see yourself in here. It's all black. You don't find a way out. You kind of are losing hope, like, am I going to be like this forever? When you get through it, grief then becomes inside of you. It doesn't take over your life. You're not in a state of grief all the time. That's the thing about, in early grief, you're in a state of grief. When you have healed through this, you will have some relief from it. You will have integrated the loss into your life, as opposed to at the beginning, you keep it away as far as you can. That's what the get busy is about. Let's not think about it, let's not talk about it, and it's always around us. You can't sleep at night, you can't eat during the day, and you feel like you're losing control. So the first, these are the four steps, four tasks, not steps. They're not linear. It doesn't kind of go like this. These are the four tasks that people have found to get through or on the other side of it. The first one is to acknowledge the death. That seems like an obvious one. They died. But it's that woman that I spoke to 6 months later, she goes, "What? What just happened?" That takes a while. But it's important to do. These were twins. They were older women, like 60 years old. Their mother died. They did not change one thing in the house for years. Because the death, they could not acknowledge that the death happened. So that's the first. I mean, it seems kind of weird, doesn't it? Because you go to the funeral, you're doing cards, but those are all kind of intellectual kinds of things. You can go through it like a robot. It is only when we feel it right here, where it aches, where all of a sudden we're starting to get a new understanding of what you just went through. Acknowledge the death, feel the feelings. This one is the hardest, I would think, for most of us, because the feelings are so powerful and so strong and so unexpected. They're scary. You know, the obvious one is sadness, fear, what's going to happen to me, fear of I'm losing my mind, I can't think straight, I can walk in a room, I don't know why I'm there. I forget things. I feel like I'm going to lose my job if I'm working because I can't hold it together anymore. Anger, resentment. Why did this have to happen? Why is it happening to me all the time? What about all those other people that don't contribute to anything in life? Why are they gone and my beloved is gone? All those kinds of things surface. We don't feel good feeling some of them either. But I would venture to say with the anger and resentment that that's not the first time you felt it. That you may have had, and that's the whole thing about paying attention, is there are people who are the half full glass and the people with the half empty glass. And those kinds of personality traits will be exaggerated when you're grieving. Your defenses will be stretched now to the extent that sometimes they may just collapse. Acknowledge the death, feel the feelings. Any other feelings that someone may experience?
Numbness,
the shock. Yeah. There's a woman that I know whose father died, and she wasn't even close to her father, which would go to the complicated business, but she was just destroyed. And she went to counseling. I suggested she go to another person. And in the course of that discussion, she finally, after 23 years, talked about her first husband who committed suicide. She had never spoke about this before because she couldn't acknowledge it herself. So, yeah. You feel the vortex, that's the other thing that people talk about. I feel like I'm getting pulled in. You feel like a heavy laden. You got a big weight on your shoulders. Yeah. It's a very, very sad situation for lots of family members because that's the biggest disappointment, is that you're not getting support from your family or your friends. And there are a number of, anybody else feel that with their friends or family? One of the reasons that that can happen is, again, because everybody grieves differently. Some people don't grieve. Some people button it up and go on their merry way. Some people may have feelings about you grieving. Oh, there she goes again, you know. And some people believe, and this is unfortunate, but I had mentioned it before, we're not going to bring it up because you're going to get upset. And what happens is that we get more upset. So what I suggest is for people to bring his name up. Bring their name up. Do you remember when so-and-so did this and this? You know, bring up the memory for a number of reasons. One of them, it's good for you, but you're letting people know that it's okay to do and nothing horrible will happen. You cry. Big deal. I believe that it gets everybody. If it doesn't get you emotionally, guess what? It gets you physically. Here's a woman that I spoke to. She was referred by a physician and she thought she was having a heart attack. She talked about the pain in your heart right here. And so he took her through all these tests and everything was negative. And then, thank God, he asked the second question, so what's your life like? And she talked about missing her sister because her sister had died like 2 months earlier. So I had seen her. Her husband was not very supportive. And so she spoke like from here. You know how when you're grieving, you kind of hold your breath? You just don't, it was very shallow. And after she spoke nonstop for like an hour, all of a sudden she went like this. And that was such a, I mean, obviously I still remember it because it was such a concrete example of how when we do not honor our own grief, we basically hold our breath. Yeah. Acknowledge, feel, adapt. That can be as obvious as you have to do a funeral. You know, you have to do a burial. But it goes to, I need a job. I got to get a job. I don't know how to do my financials. I've got to learn something. Interestingly enough, when I used to do group, the joke was people would bring the mail, they would get the mail, and they would put it on the dining room table. Lots of people had dining room tables where their mail got stacked up on the table or in a, see? Or in a paper bag. It went right in there because who wants to deal with that? You are consumed with everything in your life about your death, let alone a utility bill. I remember looking, like, why wasn't my headline on the Globe about my baby dying? I mean, I do remember feeling that when I saw this stupid headline and going, why aren't I there? That's how compulsive it is. That's how involved it is. It consumes us. That's what I mean by we're inside of it. Adapting. How else do we adapt?
Go back to work.
Go back to work. Soul, we're a soul parent now. We have to somehow figure out how to do that. Many times the firsts, especially if you've had like vacation homes or you've had certain rituals that you go through or certain traditions, every time you go through that new thing, it's going to bring it up because, of course, you're looking for your partner.
Does it stop? I mean, does it stop at some point?
It lessens, and it may stop, yeah. You know. Just don't, I mean, one of the things that I think is really important with grief is to be honest with ourselves.
Right.
Don't pretend that it's not bothering you. If it's bothering you, own it. It's very hard. But that's your way of taking care of yourself. You owe it to yourself. You've had a loving, wonderful relationship. It may have being complicated, it may have been arguments, but you deserve that time to honor your relationship. So yeah, I mean, what will happen besides being annoyed by it or confused by it, you'll smile when you get through it. It's like, oh geez, of course I remember this, you know, or I remember. It'll be a memory. I always talk about photographs. Some people leave the photographs, don't move them, and other people take the photographs away. They can't look at them. Those photographs that make you cry at the beginning will make you smile when you get on the other side of it. It's when we are in deep grief, we don't want anything to change. You know, so if my father gave me that book, don't anybody touch it, please. And for heaven's sakes, you can't move it. Because all the love has been put on that book. When we get through this grief, that love then goes back here. Because when we're hurting, we close up. We don't want to be hurt anymore. And so we put it away. And it's a wonderful thing. I used to have a sweater. It was a horrible sweater that my dad would wear all the time. But I kept it on my chair. I maybe wore it twice, but I was there, never washed it, just kept it right there. I don't know what it did to me. It gave me some kind of presence or something until maybe 2 years, 3 years, I looked at it and it goes, God, it's an awful sweater. And out it went. I could pass it on. So it's the same thing with little, I mean, you're going to keep some things. My mom kept my dad's sweatshirt that said Cleveland Browns on it. I mean, until she died, I'm sure. But if you are keeping every, I know one woman who could not change her mother's bedroom to the point of the dirty Kleenexes. It is so sad, because you wonder, one of the things you understand if you go through this, and I tell people, remember how hard it is, because when you hear another story from somebody else, you won't judge. You'll know how extreme behavior can get. And it's frightening. One of the things that some people, and not many people talk about this, is you wish your life would end. I'm done with this, you know? It's very different from suicide. It's the desire for all this to leave. And I had that experience where I was sitting at the table. This was after our baby died. And I had the glass. It was a pottery glass, a wine glass. And I was sitting at the table feeling so bad, and I said, I wish I could jump in that glass and drown. Now, I mean, what's the likelihood of? But it was my desire to end this suffering. And that's what it was. And once I could realize it or talk about it, it dissipates. It didn't have power over me. It just showed how deeply I was hurting. The fourth task, and this is the one that many people never get to, not because it's so hard, but because it demands a choice, and that is to reinvest in life again. Many people in this culture, at least, give me a pill, please, so that this will go away. They just want the pain to stop. I come from the place of we can learn something about suffering. Here's a quote. I do not believe that sheer tough suffering teaches. If suffering alone taught, all the world would be wise, since everyone suffers. To suffering must be added mourning, understanding, patience, love, openness, and the willingness to remain vulnerable. You know who said that? Anne Morrell Lindbergh. She lost her baby. Her baby was kidnapped. It was a famous case. That's who wrote that. She learned something about suffering, and I think that is available to all of us. So the question could be, what helps us get through this? Do any of you have your secrets of how you got through this? Music. See, what's interesting, I come from a musical family. And so when my dad died, he was a musician. At Christmas time, I'm the one who wanted to put the music on. And I'm the one who sat there and cried the whole time. And that was fine with me. It wasn't so fine for everybody else who picked up the dishes, started washing the dishes, you know. But see, that's what I mean by everybody has their own thing. All I'm suggesting is don't be afraid to let the feelings out. The car and music is like torture, because you feel like you're trapped in here. All you have to do is turn the dial. Or a movie. A movie is a very good vicarious way to let some feelings out. Just cry, you know. It's about a stupid movie, but you know what you're crying about. It's just one step removed. Social interaction, you know, it gets claustrophobic with staying in your house in your own mind, because it keeps going over. It's like a stuck record. You go over it and over it and over it and over it, you know. Here, you get fresh air getting here, and you see people who may share the same thing. Walking outside, getting outside, it's really important to do. There's something about the air that goes into our lungs. And I'm saying this with everything that I say, there's a little parenthesis, this is hard. This is hard to do, you know? Because we usually kind of wait until we feel like it. And you can't wait, because that's built on emotion, and you're emotionally sapped right now. So you have to make it from, you have to make the decision from your head. You know, this is what I'm going to do tomorrow at 10 o'clock. I'm going for a walk. And if you can do that yourself, great. If you can't, that's when your friends who say, what can I do for you? You tell them, call me at 10 o'clock or come over and pick me up at 10 o'clock so we can go for a walk. You get very practical at this point. Yeah. Exercise. Get to the huff and puff is what I say, because we're in our heads all the time. It's like a natural meditation almost. I always say to stay with people who are loving to you, and stay with things or go to things that are beautiful. Museums, art, concerts, anything that will feed your soul right now, because your soul is becoming depleted. We're wounded people when we're, and we need to have some salve, some ointment to help us heal. Breathing. This is such a basic element of our life, but as I said earlier, we hold it when we're in pain. Do you ever, in physical pain, do you ever hurt your back and you walk around like this all the time? We stop breathing. When we stop breathing, we're not, literally, we're not giving oxygen to our muscles. That's why we become stiff. But breathing is a force of life. And that's your struggle right now, is what kind of life do I want? Do I want a life? Breathe. And do it slowly and do it consciously. So you would sit, feet flat on the floor, and slowly breathe in 10 times. In, out. And you're going to watch your mind get very busy, but don't worry about that. Just keep breathing in and out. I would suggest to plan something for the following day, before you go to bed. What one thing can you do for yourself? And write it down. And if you need somebody to help you get through that, call them and ask them. Some people ask, what can I do? Ask them to cook you a meal. Ask them to bring you flowers. You know, ask them to write about your loved one. What's your best memory that you've had? I remember one woman in the group, her husband died like 6 months earlier, and it was getting to be spring or fall, one of those two. And she said, I went to the garage and I took out a saw. She goes like this. She took out a saw and she started, you know, trimming the bushes. She said it gave her such power, like the song. You know, she said, now I know how guys get off on this, you know? It's like, but it was a visual for her that she was taking control of her life through her yard.
Did she destroy the plants? Because that's what I might have done.
Well, there's another woman who went to the garage and took all the plates and threw them up against the wall like this. Yeah. Very vicarious for her. Or there was another.
Clean it up.
She probably had somebody else to do that. Yeah. What mourning is accepting what we have rather than what we want. And you may hear people say all the time, stay in the present, stay in the present. That's what that means. And when we stay in the present, we need then to face ourselves. Where am I? What am I doing? How rotten do I feel? And then the last thing I'd like to talk about is, why do we have to do this? Why do we have to grieve? Just a little more about the anticipatory grief. That can be as short as 3 months and as long as a year or two. Because like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, you know the road it's going down. And so how do you live a life as a partner knowing that? And that's a difficult thing. And the thing about it is that you can't totally complete your grieving process because the person is still alive. You can only go up to a certain point. It's probably one of the torturous kinds of anticipatory griefs there is. What happens when we express our feelings, we talk about our feelings, is that it gives us a chance to clarify what exactly we're feeling. If we don't look at ourselves, we are a mumble jumble. Nothing makes sense. And so it's like when the classic thing is sitting on an airplane and you're talking to this person you don't know and you're talking about your life, and then you go, oh, I just feel so much better. We don't usually want any advice. We just want somebody to listen to us and to tell us, I hear you. That gives us some relief that we're not alone. It also gives some clarification because I finally said something out loud. Many times it reduces a fear, because if we keep it a secret, it becomes very powerful. Once we say it out loud, it doesn't sound so bad. And if it does, we can do something about it. The other thing about grieving is that it allows us to feel compassion for other people. Loss is universal. And many people are experiencing the same loss you do. And so if we can join in that space of love and compassion, once you give it to yourself, you will very easily give it to other people. It's fear that stops us. Fear that, oh my God, if I talk about it, I'm never. Fear that if I start crying, I'll never stop. I mean, that's a common thing. And yes, I can tell you that you will. We usually grieve longer than we want and longer than we thought. The one thing that helps us, or the first step to know we're on the right path, is when we start feeling gratitude. Gratitude that this person was in our life. Gratitude for what this person gave us. Gratitude for my own life. Because now we've opened our hearts up. The only way to get through this is to get our hearts open again. And that is done by trust, because we've lost trust in life now. You know, what's going to happen? It's like death is right here. That's what I remember. It's like, when's it going to happen again? We're on guard. Once we let our guard down and start to trust again, that's why you need to stay with people who love you and support you. Not the people who are questioning you, and not the people who make snide remarks about you. You want to stay away from them. Get with people who let you be who you are so that you can share what you're going through. There's one more thing I want to read to you. It's two things, really. The most beautiful people we have known are those who have known defeat, known suffering, known struggle, known loss, and have found their way out of the depths. These persons have an appreciation, sensitivity, and an understanding of life that fills them with compassion, gentleness, and a deep loving concern. Beautiful people just don't happen. That's for all of us. And this one, I love this one. That was by Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who really was the first person to acknowledge that dying people have feelings and go through a process. Our life has not been an ascent up one side of a mountain and down the other. We did not reach a peak only to decline and die. We have been as drops of water, born in the ocean and sprinkled on the earth in a gentle rain. We became a spring and then a stream, and finally a river flowing deeper and stronger, nourishing all it touches as it nears its home once again. Don't accept the modern myths of aging. You are not declining. You are not fading away into uselessness. You are a sage, a river at its deepest and most nourishing. Sit by a river bank sometime and watch attentively as the river tells you of your life. That's what this gives. When you get on the other side of this, you know, in the olden days, the dying were the teachers of life. You'll know something about life that people who haven't experienced a loss will not know, because you're fighting for it now. You're trying to get on the other side of it. You're trying to figure out where all this fits in, and it may not fit in at all. But you'll know what's the most important, and that's love. That's the only way we get through this. One of the things that I believe in is pain becomes a great motivator. You know, when at the very beginning, pain almost becomes a companion because, you know why we're hurting, and so we feel like our partner or our loved one is right there. But after a while, it just doesn't do it. We get kind of sick of feeling this way. You know, sometimes we need extra help, you know, either a support group, sometimes individual counseling, so that we don't have to, I mean, it can get so bad that we don't really want to listen to anybody else. We just want to talk about ourselves. And so a little one-on-one for a period of time may be something to kind of help us get over a stuck feeling. I've started in hospice as a bereavement volunteer and then became coordinator. And when my first patient died, I remember at the supper table, I said to my husband and two kids, boys, two little boys, oh, so-and-so died today. And they, and my son, my youngest son, who was probably seven, why didn't you save him? Now, obviously, I remember that because it's like, well, that's what we're supposed to do in life, is help people and make them. But this was different. And so I remember that. So it's like, well, what am I? I asked myself driving here, why are you coming here? What do you want to share with them? In hospice, it's a very, it's like a lab that allows you to experience anything that's unfinished in your life, hopefully. So I do not vicariously experience grief all the time. If I do, I'd go see somebody, because something, I'm not paying attention to something. My focus when I'm sitting with somebody is on you. If something is coming up for me that interferes with me listening to you, I need to take care of that. That's the opportunity, I think, that people in a very, even if you're sitting with a friend of yours and they're talking about their loss and you start talking about the loss of your dog, something's interfered with you listening to your friend. And there's nothing wrong with it. That's why I say be honest with yourself, because that's the only way you'll be clear. In grief, we are off balance. We don't operate at our highest capacity. So knowing that, you kind of give yourself a break. How do I get myself in balance? And that's why going outside, going to a museum, doing some art, doing a going to church, whatever kind of pulls you into some sensibility, that's what you practice. That's what you practice. And that's how we get our balance back. For those of you who've lost partners, people tell me they feel exposed. Doesn't everybody know that I'm single now? Or do people know that I'm lost a partner? Do they know that? Is a big W on my, and then you find out there are a lot of people who are single. There are a lot of people who have lost their partners. So I think it's just, we're in it. We're submerged in it. When somebody says, you know, what do I do with their things? So people tell me to do it right away. Other people say, no, I say, I don't care. It doesn't make any difference when you do them. What's more important is that you do this. And when you talk to a lot of people, they do it a lot of different ways. There are very few who do it that day. The day of the funeral, boom, everything's out. That doesn't mean your grief is done. When we lost our baby, somebody gave us a cottage up in Vermont. And I went, great. I mean, really, I was smiling, great. I can escape it. Yeah. It was one of the saddest days when I got up there and said, I guess this doesn't work this way. These are all realizations of, what was I going to say, though? I lost my train. Oh, the selling of the house and the passing of the clothes. So some people do it, they set a date. I'm going to do it at 6 months. Other people do it gradually. First, I'm going to get rid of the underwear, and then the socks, and then, you know. Some people don't touch it for a year. Again, be honest with yourself. Why aren't you doing this, you know? Is it that you're going to move the book, and what's going to happen then, you know? Look at what you're holding on to, and is it doing it for you? There's something about we need to hold on to things. That's the whole process of mourning. But what's our resistance to it? What are we afraid of that's going to happen? And most of the time, it's that we're alone. So I want to thank you for sitting and sharing what you've shared.